Hello class, Mr. Belden here for another chapter summary video. Moving on to chapter 7, which starts with the question, what role should consumerism play in our economy? Of course, to answer that, we need to look at consumerism. What is it? Now, consumerism is another one of those words where the economic meaning is a little different from how it's often used. It's a word we tend to hear the most around Christmas time when people start talking about how it's ruining the spirit of Christmas. If you've ever seen a Christmas special, you might get this idea that consumerism is about being greedy and obsessed with buying things.
It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags.
As usual, this is partly true, but not quite right. Going to the book, we see that consumerism is defined as an economic theory that links prosperity to consumer demand for goods and services, and that makes consumer behavior central to economic decision making. Basically, this means that when the economy is strong, people are willing and able to buy things, so understanding consumer behavior is important to running an economy. So this chapter is going to look at factors that affect the choices we make as consumers and how those choices affect the economy. One of the first factors that affects consumer behavior is the idea of identity. People tend to buy things that represent the image they have of themselves. This can range from fashion and clothing to the type of cars people choose to buy and even the hobbies they pursue.
If I saw something clever like a little coffee table in the shape of a yin-yang, I had to have it. The Klipsch personal office unit, the Hovatrek home exerbike, or the Yohannishov sofa with the string green stripe pattern. Even the Rizlampa wire lamps of environmentally friendly unbleached paper. I'd flip through catalogs and wonder, what kind of dining set defines me as a person?
Another factor that affects consumer decision is health and safety concerns. Health and safety can determine what things consumers are able to buy. Some products like alcohol and tobacco are restricted for health reasons. This also works the other way with consumer demands for safety driving product changes. Certain products like cars are often judged on their safety ratings. As people have become more health conscious, it's become more common for restaurants to cater to this demand, and it's now common to find things like vegetarian and gluten-free options on menus. One of the reasons consumers are such an important aspect of the economy is because of how many jobs are made available by the things consumers buy. The effects can be much further reaching than you might expect. Imagine you go to a store to buy a pen. Think of all the jobs that need to be done to make that happen. You bought the pen in a store, so there needed to be a retail worker, salespeople, the managers to keep the store running. That pen had to get to the store somehow, so we need truckers, warehouse workers, and the various support staff to keep everything organized. The pen was made in a factory, so we need factory workers, mechanics, and more support staff to put it all together. The factory needs raw materials, so there had to be metal refineries, plastic manufacturers. They get their raw materials from miners and chemists. It might seem like we're stretching the effects of your pen purchase, but if a large number of consumers suddenly decide to just stop buying pens for some reason, it would have a big effect on all of these other jobs. As consumers become increasingly aware of the effects their choices have on the environment, environmental concerns have had an increasingly large effect on the economy. Some of this is a legal requirement. The government puts limits on how much companies can pollute through things like clean air laws. Companies also voluntarily make their products more environmentally friendly to appeal to eco-minded consumers. Products like recycled paper, dolphin-safe tuna, and cosmetics that aren't tested on animals are all an example of how environmental concerns have affected consumerism. The final factor we're going to be talking about is marketing. Marketing is a broad term to cover the various ways that producers try to convince consumers to purchase their products. The bandwagon effect encourages you to buy a product or service because everyone else is. You'll see some call to join a community or imply you're already part of one through use of that product or service.
Thank you.
Advertising through emotional appeal is similar. These ads use strong emotional language that connects with your fears and desires.
You're leaking, aging, hairy, overweight, and everything hurts. And your children's clothes are filthy. Sort yourself out.
Now I'm free to live my own life, my way.
Glittering generalities relates the product or service to words or images that promise everything but deliver little or nothing. These tend to be words or phrases that sound positive, but when you think about them, they don't actually really mean anything.
moisture is the essence of wetness. And wetness is the essence of beauty.
Testimonials use celebrities or experts to speak for a product. Sometimes these ads imply the person is an expert and can be trusted to accurately gauge the quality of the product. Other times they just choose a popular celebrity to make the ad more memorable and to draw in fans of that person. A plain folks appeal is sort of the other side of that same coin. As people begin to doubt the sincerity of paid advertisements, we've seen a rise in ads promoting the experience of ordinary people. So these are the ads that are always sure to tell you that the person is not an actor.
Nice to meet you too.
So, we invited you here today to get your honest opinion about this new car.
Some sort of luxury import.
The front end of the car, it's got a little bit of a snarl.
Scientific appeal is the use of statistics or scientific data to persuade customers to buy a product or service.
Tom, for unpleasing breath, I advise Colgate Dental Cream. Because only Colgate's has proved so completely it stops bad breath. Scientific tests prove that in 7 out of 10 cases, Colgate's instantly stops unpleasing breath that originates in the mouth. Yes, Colgate's has the proof. It cleans your breath while it cleans your teeth. Moreover, Colgate's is preferred for flavor over all other brands tested. And dental research has proved brushing teeth right after eating with Colgate Dental Cream stops tooth decay best.
Finally, I want to talk about how consumerism can empower you. Consumers as a group actually wield a lot of power through their control of spending habits. We already talked about how consumer demand drives companies to change the products they offer. We often call this voting with your dollar, since much like an election, each consumer alone has little power, but the consensus of consumers as a whole can destroy a company. A more direct version of this is a boycott. Instead of choosing to spend money on a product they like, consumers can all vocally refuse to support something they dislike and encourage other consumers to do the same. This has been done successfully to get companies to be more environmentally conscious or to put pressure on companies that use child labor or sweatshops to produce their products. This, of course, relies on getting a big chunk of the company's consumers to agree with the boycott, which isn't easy. It's common for boycotts to fail when the cause is something that not many people care about. You may have heard of various movies, TV shows, and video games ignoring boycotts, when fans got mad about aspects of their products, or when people tried to boycott Starbucks when their mugs just weren't Christmassy enough. In conclusion, consumerism is a double-edged sword with both positive and negative qualities. Think back to the opening question. Right now, consumerism plays a large role in our economy. What do you think of this? Should consumerism play a larger role or a smaller role? Let me know.